Up next, the roundtable takes on possible legal jeopardy for former President Trump, plus the fallout after the consequential Supreme Court decision upholding two restrictive voting laws in Arizona. Stay with us, our
The radical left continues to search for a crime and wreck lives, break laws, violate every principle of justice, fairness, and liberty. You see it. You see it on a constant basis. It's really called prosecutorial misconduct. You didn't pay tax on the car or a company apartment or education for your grandchildren. I don't even know. Do you have to? But does anybody know the answer to that stuff?
Former President Trump sounding off last night after prosecutors in New York indicted the Trump Organization and its CFO on tax fraud charges. Here to discuss that and much more, Time national political correspondent Molly Ball, ABC News Deputy Political Director Avery Harper, Washington Post national correspondent Mary Jordan, and ABC News contributor LZ Granderson, host of ABC's Life Out Loud podcast. Great to see all of you on this 4th of July, and thanks for coming in. And Avery, I want to start with Donald Trump. The case against the Trump Organization and its CFO, President Trump was not himself charged, but this is his namesake company. How big of a deal is this?
Well, listen, the investigation is ongoing in the New York State's Attorney General's office and the Manhattan DA's office. And so if there's any evidence that surfaces that implicates the president, he could be in legal jeopardy. And look, Alan Weisselberg is facing 15 felonies. And so we don't know what he's going to do. We know that that the former president spoke with John Santucci earlier this week. And he said he didn't believe that Weisselberg would flip on him. But listen, time will tell.
And Molly, the former president has, you heard, blasted the charges as partisan, no surprise there. But do you think he's at all worried? I was also fascinated by what he said there. It's almost as if he admitted that all really happened, that they didn't pay taxes.
Well, and you see him trying to run the same playbook that he did for the scandals that beset him during his administration, right? Portray it as a partisan witch hunt, and then basically in a way admit to things while claiming that they're all okay, they're all normal, these are all regular ways of doing business, that anyone would be perplexed by the kinds of things being charged by the prosecutors. The question is, does that hit the same when you're not president anymore? When you're just a guy throwing a rally and you don't even have a Twitter account, does it have the same resonance? Does it affect the course of events? And I think what he's going to find is the prosecutors in New York are relatively immune to that kind of pressure. And so the question will be, does that have any effect, or is he going to have to mount some more formal defense?
And Mary, what's also notable in this is what wasn't in the indictment. Nothing on the alleged hush money paid to Stormy Daniels, nor inflating assets, as Michael Cohen testified before Congress. Do you think those charges are still possible?
Well, as several people have said, this is the first series of indictments. There's much more to come, they think. But also, people are worried. Like, this is all they have? They've been talking to Michael Cohen, his fixer and lawyer, for a long time, the prosecutors. Now they're trying to get another person who's been on the inside for five decades. Clearly, the feeling is that they want more to get this guy. I mean, he has been Houdini. He beat impeachment twice. It's been very hard to get him, but it is really interesting that now he's not saying he didn't do this. He's just saying, hey, it's not murder.
Yeah, that's exactly right. LZ, former President Trump is still teasing a comeback, of course, running again in 2024. Do you think that's something the Republican Party would welcome?
It seems so, because they're still willing to follow his lead in a lot of areas. I mean, if you think about all of the bills that are being passed across the country right now in terms of, you know, voter registration and voter restrictions, they are all based upon the lie that came from Trump, who's the original source of all of this. So I think there's legislative proof that, yes, they're still willing to follow his lead, despite the fact that he has these allegations around him.
You don't think there's anything behind the scenes there, Republicans saying, we got to follow him now, but whew, hopefully he won't run?
I mean, they've been saying that for 5 years. We got to follow him now. They've just been following him.
Okay. And on the January 6th committee, Avery, this week the House voted to establish a select committee to investigate the attack on the U.S. Capitol on January 6th. Two Republicans, voted for it. And Speaker Pelosi tapped one of them, Liz Cheney, to serve on the committee. So can this kind of committee really get to the bottom of this?
Well, listen, I think the folks who have been appointed to that committee are certainly going to try. And it was really important for Speaker Pelosi to nominate and to appoint Liz Cheney to that position, because regardless of what the minority leader, Kevin McCarthy, does, whether he decides he's going to put some far right or Trump loyalists onto that committee, or he decides not to put any Republicans up for that committee at all, there is going to be a bipartisan group of lawmakers trying to get to the bottom of what happened on January 6th.
And Molly, Republicans are already blasting this as partisan. And how will it work for them? How does Kevin McCarthy choose people to be on the committee?
Well, the ball is really in Kevin McCarthy's court, and he has repeatedly declined to say whether he's going to appoint anyone to this committee at all. The feeling on Capitol Hill is that he probably will, but then will those people see their role primarily as undermining the committee, as trying to prevent it from going to certain places, particularly as it looks to former President Trump's role in the events of January 6th, because that is really the sort of red hot center of all of the controversy surrounding this committee. So, you know, what it's less about what it will find, I think, since there are, as Republicans have repeatedly said, so many other agencies and law enforcement jurisdictions looking at what happened, unearthing the evidence, charging individuals. It's more about, as the 9/11 Commission did, bringing all that evidence together to create a shared understanding, a shared narrative that Americans can use to understand. And so, you know, the Republicans don't want to be part of that process, and they have succeeded, I think, in large part in preventing there from being a sort of bipartisan shared America of this traumatic event. So I don't know how successful the committee can be going forward in that circumstance.
And LZ, what do you think the committee can accomplish, and particularly the racism that was evident on January 6th? I was up there, lots of white supremacists, lots of Confederate flags. How do you think this will play out?
You know, I think this committee serves two purposes. One, obviously, is to get to the bottom of what happened. But then the other is also to send a clear message to people who are thinking or who may be on the fence in terms of where they want to pledge their allegiances. You know, where I grew up in Detroit, we had this phrase, you don't want that smoke. And basically what that means is, there might be trouble that you might talk a good game about, but when real pressure comes and real accountability is being held, people who really aren't fully committed to a certain cause may begin to back down. So hopefully just the presence of this committee at least gives people who don't want that smoke, who like talking and tweeting, but won't do things that are dangerous and impact the larger society.
And Mary, how do you think this will impact the midterms? Before voting down that 9/11 style independent commission, several Republicans said they were really worried about this dragging into 2022.
I think all this is, it's all about the midterms. It's crucial. Kevin McCarthy could become the House Speaker if they gain back. You know, not going to take too many seats. And what they don't want, what the Republicans don't want is, you know, can imagine all the TV clips of a police officer talking about what happened, that he couldn't get back up, that it was right from the top, from the president on down. So I think that eventually the truth will be known. But right now there's a lot of Republicans who are trying to put the brakes on it because of the midterms.
And Avery, I want to turn to the Supreme Court and the voting rights ruling in this case out of Arizona. Explain the case and what you think this will mean.
Well, it was a 6-3 decision on ideological lines to uphold voting restrictions in Arizona that Democrats and voting advocates called discriminatory on the basis of race. And because of this decision, it's going to deal a blow to that fight against what voting advocates would call voter suppression in Republican-led states across the country. And the fact is that the American people are not on the side of the Republican lawmakers in some of these states. 2-1, if you look at the ABC Washington Post poll, you see that Americans believe that it is more important to have voting laws that make it easier to vote lawfully than laws that make it harder to vote fraudulently.
And particularly in Georgia, everyone's looking at Georgia right now, Molly.
That's right. Although this is, you know, all over the country that these kinds of laws are being considered and passed. And you know, frankly, the sort of Democratic establishment is concerned that they have not effectively countered this push. Whether you're talking about in Congress, where the big, you know, what they call democracy reform bill went down, or whether you're talking about in the states, where I think this case more than anything sent a clear signal about how the Supreme Court is going to look at the Democratic attempts to litigate these laws, the lawsuits that are being brought in various states. And in Georgia, you have the Justice Department involved. That, of course, makes it a different story than simply a lawsuit. But even there, you have to wonder about, you know, how the courts are going to look at attempts to combat these laws using the legal system. And so if it's not going to happen on Capitol Hill, it's not going to happen in the courts, then it has to happen in the political process. And it's going to be about, you know, as Avery is saying, using the fact that these laws are unpopular to try to motivate Democratic voters.
And exactly, LZ, as Avery pointed out and Molly pointed out, not exactly in line with public opinion.
No, of course not. But they don't really care about public opinion, right? If they did, then all of this legislation would be looking at differently. You know, the thing that really frustrates me most is that the justices acknowledge that these new laws does impact minorities. They didn't deny that aspect of it. They just said that the inconvenience of it isn't so great. Well, they're all privileged. And I grew up poor. I remember my mom scraping together 50 cents, 75 cents, a dollar just for gas money to get to the grocery store. When you do that to polling places, now you're forcing minorities to decide whether or not they're going to invest money, gas money, to get to the polling places that are now far further away, or do I use this gas money to get to the grocery store, or do I get to work? They're privileged saying that this doesn't inconvenience them enough. Well, how do you know? When was the last time you were that poor?
I'd like to talk about, I went down to Mississippi and I saw this, and on the morning of the election, people would turn out and the polling place would be closed in the place where there were a lot of Democratic voters. And so the question then was, okay, do I drive? Do I spend another, you know, 45 minutes in the car to go there and then wait in a really long line? There's all kinds of dirty tricks being played about closing polls, switching where you're supposed to be, telling people they're in the wrong place, even if they're in the right place. I think if people really knew what was going on, because it differs state by state and county by county, they would think, you know what, it's July 4th here. It's all about voting, right? It's the most fundamental of rights. We had the Boston Tea Party because we couldn't vote. We were getting taxed. And it's kind of shocking that right now a lot of people don't have the same access to votes as other Americans.
But we certainly, Molly, wouldn't be shocked by the Supreme Court decision and the direction it went.
No, I don't think so. I mean, I think given that the way the court is composed, and what you hear from a lot of conservatives, too, is that this decision was rather limited. It applied to a couple of specific situations, to, you know, specifically votes in the wrong precinct and ballot harvesting. It wasn't about closing polling places or a lot of the other things that have been alleged. So in some quarters on the right, there's a feeling that the Democrats are sort of hyperventilating about this. But, you know, it obviously has implications for so many other cases that are being brought and so many other laws that are being litigated across the country.
And Avery, speaking of Democrats, does this up the pressure on moderate Democrats like Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema to push harder for new voting legislation or what?
Well, listen, this is definitely going to revive the conversation around eliminating the filibuster. And for those Democrats who've been wary of filibuster reform, this is going to be a confrontation to them. They're going to have to square their defense of a legislative body with the protection of voting rights for American voters who are really at the heart of the democracy that they say they hold dear. Okay.